let's go to let's first go to amlodipine.
Amlodipine is a calcium antagonist. So let me tell you what a calcium antagonist does. And we have voltage sensitive calcium channels throughout our body. These are channels through which calcium can move into the cell, initiate a biological reaction, and then move out again. So these are very important for controlling the lung function.
And we have we want to block these channels. We want a calcium antagonist. So we want to block those channels, and we want to inhibit what's called excitation contraction function.
Now, if we do that in vascular smooth muscle, and this is a smooth muscle throughout the body which contains the blood vessels and, you know, contains your blood,
if we block calcium channels on vascular smooth muscle,
your arteries are relaxed and your blood pressure drops. So if you want a drug for high blood pressure, then a calcium antagonist is ideal. It blocks the channel on the artery, then you relax, and down goes blood. Now, you can also block calcium channels on the heart. If you block the calcium channel on the heart, the coronary arteries relax, more blood goes through into the heart, and during an angina attack, you starve the blood. So you can see with that mechanism, you get more blood to the heart, you can treat angina. So with one mechanism, calcium antagonist, we can design drugs that can treat both hypertension and angina. Now, as I said, calcium channels are present throughout the body. And we have calcium channels on our heart. And if you block the calcium channel on the heart, the rate of contraction and the force of contraction will decrease. So the cardiac function will be depressed, and we don't want to do that. So if we're interested in a calcium antagonist, then we really have to have one that only works on vascular smooth muscle and which doesn't work on the heart. So that's why we're interested in the area. Now, when we looked in the literature, where are we going to start? We don't know the structure of the channel. We don't know what it looks like. So we've got to imagine, you know, what sort of structures might interact and how we might manipulate them. So there was a compound called nifedipine, which is what we call a dihydropyridine. It's a calcium antagonist that was used for the treatment of the hypertension. However, it had serious drawbacks. It's not soluble in water, so that means it's very erratically absorbed from the body. Different patients get different doses. It's rapidly metabolized, it's rapidly broken down by enzymes in the body, so it has a short duration of action. You have to take it 2 or 3 times a day, which is not very convenient. And also there's a chemical reaction here, which I won't go into, but it makes the molecule unstable, and you have to use the molecule in darkened conditions. And the other problem was there were 90 patents around the structure. It's quite a simple structure, but there were 90 patents. So it's difficult to imagine anything we could do there. We then looked, this is another calcium antagonist, which is called the diazam. It is a completely different chemical structure. It has no relationship with nifedipine, but it is a calcium antagonist. However, when we evaluated the compound in the lab, we could not show that this had any calcium antagonist activity at all. It was pharmacologically inert as far as we could see, so it was not a very good starting point. And the other option we had was a compound called verapamil, which for the medicinal chemist is not very interesting, not very easy to manipulate, and the ratio of activity between the vasculature and the heart was low. So this is a very difficult compound to use in the clinic. It's usually used for cardiac arrhythmias. It's not used very much for hypertension and angina. So we're drawn back to the therapy, and that's where we're going to start, but this is a molecule with a few problems. As I said, poorly soluble, rapidly metabolized and unstable, and 90 patents. So we have to do something that's completely novel and nobody's thought about before. Well, first of all, understand the problems. Why is it rapidly metabolized? Well, in our liver, we have enzymes called cytochrome P450s. And enzymes carry out chemical reactions of various types, and I'm sure you're all aware of them. This enzyme, the cytochrome P450, oxidizes, it takes that hydrogen and that hydrogen from the dihydropyridine and generates the pyridine. And the pyridine is totally inactive. And different people carry out this reaction at different rates, so different people have different duration of action, very difficult to control and very inconvenient. Also, it's insoluble. Now, if you have a compound that's insoluble, you take it by mouth in the gut, which is an aqueous situation, and you get very erratic absorption. So that's not good for the patient either. So we've got to look at that.
So we thought about the mechanism with this oxidation. And we thought that if we put something here at what we call the 2 position, we thought that that would block the approach of amlodipine to the enzyme. Because there's more bulk there, the enzyme has a restricted active site to carry out the reaction. We put some bulk at the 2 position, we thought that would slow down the metabolic oxidation. We wanted to put a group here that would form what we call a hydrogen bond, an interaction with that hydrogen to stabilize. And then we wanted to put something here on the molecule that would give us solubility. So that was our design principle. It's easier to make molecules, but it's less easy to design molecules. And as you saw, there were 90 patents in the area. People had just made hundreds and thousands of molecules. None of them were any improvement at all. You have to sit back and ask, what am I trying to improve and improve? And we're trying to improve metabolic stability and solubility. Now, there's what we call a nitro group here. These can be toxic, so we decided to get rid of the nitro group. So I'll tell you what X became. That's our design principle. We always have a design principle. And as you don't know what the channel looks like, that's where the innovation art comes from. Imagining what the molecule is interacting with. The other thing, you have to have a method in evaluating the compound. You don't just make a compound and administer it to an animal. You have to have a set of screens which tell you the molecule has the activity you want, and those screens have to be relevant to the clinical situation. So the first thing we do is we contract the rat aorta, and we look at the ability of the compound to relax it. That tells us we've got a calcium antagonist. We then look at the guinea pig heart. We don't want to hit the guinea pig heart. So these two screens give us potency and vascular selectivity. That's what we want in the clinic. We then go into the elite-sized dog, and we look at the effect on coronary and peripheral hemodynamics. In other words, what does the compound do to peripheral blood flow and blood pressure? What does it do to coronary blood flow? And we also look at the effect of heart rate. Now, as we want, as nifedipine was 3 or 4 times daily, we want a once-daily agent. We want to come. The problem that we face with medication is people forget or don't like to take their medication. If you're taking a drug 3 or 4 times a day for hypertension, and you're asymptomatic, you don't have any symptoms, you're not motivated to take the drug, and you forget, or you just don't bother. So going once daily improves compliance. So we wanted a once daily agent. So we then administered the compound to a dog. The dog told us how much of the compound was absorbed, because we want 100% absorption, and how long the compound lasts. So it gave us a half-life here. And then there isn't an animal model of hypertension, so we then go to dogs with high blood pressure, hypertensive dogs. We look at the ability of the compound to lower blood pressure, and we look at the duration of action. And that set of screens will tell us when we've got a compound that's worth taking to the clinic. And we have numbers on all of these screens. If the compound doesn't meet the criteria, we cut it out. A lot of people carry on, even though the compound hasn't matched the criteria. We were very rigorous. It didn't match potency and selectivity, we cut it out. So then you have to think, well, what are we going to make? And in drug discovery or any science, we're not isolated. We have to be aware of what's going on in the literature. We have to read widely, we have to understand what people do. And I went down to the library one night and I picked up this journal called Archline Forschungsmittel, which is a very obscure journal, and there was a compound there called etafenone. And I looked at the etafenone and it had a structural feature here, which I thought was ideal for our calcium antagonist, It had an oxygen hydrogen bond, and this is a basic center, which will give us solubility. So I went to the lab straight away. John Stubbs was the chemist, and I said, John, why don't we put this on the dihydropyridine? And John said, that's a good idea. I've just been reading this work by Kellogg, and I know how to do the chemistry. If I'd gone to John 6 months before, he would have said, I don't know how to make it. If I'd gone 6 months after, he would have forgotten the paper. So Pasteur's dictum is chance favors the prepared mind. So we just went up on a dark December night, said, John, why don't we make it? He said, done. So you've got an idea, share it, don't keep it. You know, that is my view. Okay?
Now, the first thing we had to do was some chemistry. So the first thing, we weren't sure whether we could put a substitute at this position. The literature said we couldn't. So the first thing we did was something relatively simple. We did an amide and an amine here. This is potent, so this is nanomolar, very potent. Selective, greater than tenfold. And it's soluble. But the pharmacokinetics, the duration of action, were not good enough. So we then went to the compound we really wanted to make, and if you remember the structural feature from before, we put in the oxygen, two carbons in the basic center. This is 46129, this is our first candidate. And the half-life in the dog was 8 hours. And that the half-life is a time for the concentration to pay by 50%. Now, nifedipine has a half-life of half an hour. So already we've gone from a half-life of half an hour to 8 hours, which is a dramatic improvement. But it was very poorly tolerated in the dog. When we did our safety studies in the dog really didn't like high doses of the compound. So you could say, well, move on to another series. But we had people from drug metabolism on the project. And what they told us was that one of these methyl groups was being cleaved, eliminated by an enzyme. We're getting the compound with NH methyl here, and that was building up. So we're accumulating the metabolite, and it was the metabolite that was causing the problem. We then decided to go with the metabolite that we had a similar problem about. So finally, we nominated UK48340 as our candidate. Now, the only thing that can happen here is that the two hydrogens are oxidized, and we go to the pyridine, and the pyridine is pharmacologically inactive. So we're having metabolism, but we're going to an inactive species, and that makes things much more simple. Now, for the chemists in the audience, if you look at that structure in 2D, it may not mean very much to you. It may not tell you very much about the molecular properties. So I'm very keen on X-rays, and here's an X-ray structure of that compound that you've just seen. The two aromatic rings are orthogonal, or at right angles. They don't twist, they're orthogonal. And you wouldn't have realized that from the 2D structure. Esters are usually not present in drugs because they're unstable. But here we have a lone pair of electrons, which is delocalized into the ester. In other words, the electrons flow through here into this ester and into this ester, and that makes the ester stable. So by the electron delocalization, we've made the ester stable. Because of the electron delocalization, this is not a basic nitrogen atom. And here we've got the oxygen, which is two angstroms away from the hydrogen, which is about on the edge of a hydrogen bond, but there probably is one there. And then the basic center points out into space. So I'm always a great fan of an X-ray structure of a small molecule to understand where the electrons are and what the shape is. So let me show you some pharmacology now. This is a very important slide. What we do here, we take rat portal vein and we contract the rat portal vein. So you can see here the tension. That's the tension in the rat portal vein. We then administer the drug, and here's nifedipine, a very rapid onset of action, a very short duration, and then a very rapid offset. And that's what exactly you see in the clinic. Blood pressure goes down very quickly, there's a short duration, and then it returns. And when blood pressure goes down very quickly, you get a tachycardia, an increase in heart rate, you get flushing, and you get a headache. It's not very nice. So when we tested amlodipine in this test system, at the 1 hour time point, it looks to be very disappointing. But the person running the screen, Simon Campbell, said, I'm going to change the protocol. I'm going to let the compound equilibrate with the tissue for 3 hours, and I'm going to see what happens. Simon led the compound equilibrate with the tissue. You can see here we have a slow onset of action, a nice response, and a very slow offset of action. And that's what you want when you're treating angina hypertension. Slow onset and slow offset. Now, we sent this compound to a competitor company, and we asked what we found with it, and they said we found that the compound is completely inactive. And they had tested at the 1 hour time point, we had tested at the 3. They have taken over 2 times, we made 5.5 million. So, people discover drugs. It's the people who discover drugs. change the protocol if you don't think the protocol is telling you what you want to do. Change the protocol. Simon was very astute. So now here's some data. Now there's a whole family, as I said, of these dihydropyridines, and you don't need to look at them. There's some variations in the aromatic ring, some variations here, and we're the only company that's got the X group here at the two position. But look at the half-life, the time for the concentration to decay from 100 to 50%. You can see it's 1 hour for this compound for amlodipine, and it's 1 hour for nicardipine, and it's 30 hours for amlodipine. So we've got a dramatic increase in potency in duration of action. 30-hour half-life, you give this once a day. You don't have any formulation issue, just take it once a day. People in the audience may be taking it. It's a very forgiving drug. People usually don't know they've got it. Now, the half-life is made up of two components. The rate at which the compound is metabolized and the extent to which it distributes into the body. So if you take a non-steroidal anti-inflammatory, it tends to stay in the aqueous compartment, it doesn't distribute to the tissue, and you take two or three times a day, short duration action. The clearance is having, and also the volume distribution, and the volume distribution is just set as the anti-inflammatory. And here you can see the clearance, the metabolism of amlodipine, is lower than for these other two compounds, so we probably have blocked that metabolism that I talked about. But the volume of distribution, the ability to distribute into the tissues, is significantly higher. And because of that, the reduced metabolism and the higher volume of distribution, we get the longer half-life. And also the compound is 100% absorbed in animals and man. So we know exactly what dose we can give to people. In fact, the dose given in the clinic of amlodipine is 5 minutes or 10 minutes. That's total, not per kilogram. 5 minutes or 10 minutes. So why have we got, you could look on this as magic and just say, well, we don't understand it. But if you look at these dihydropyridines and you look at lipophilicity, which is like the fatty nature of the compound, and volume distribution, you can see there's a lovely one-to-one relationship, but amlodipine is an outlier. So we have a higher volume distribution than we would have expected. So why might that be? Well, these molecules, as I say, distribute into the membranes. And what we think is within the membrane, there is a hydrophobic interaction. That's, if you like, a fatty type interaction here. But also in the membrane, there is a phospholipid head group here, which is negatively charged. And we think there's an interaction between the positively charged ammonium center here, the negatively charged phospholipid head group. So we've now got two interactions. We've got the hydrophobic and we've got the ionic. To establish those interactions takes time, that's why it's a slow onset. And to break those interactions takes time, that's why it's a slow offset. So we think, again, when you see phenomena where you see things you don't understand, try and develop a rationale. Don't just say, well, you had a longer duration action. Now, what does this mean to the patient? Well, if you take a short-acting dihydropyridine, you tend to take a higher dose to get some sort of duration action, and you immediately get into the plasma levels for side effects. When you take amlodipine, you can see it takes 7 days to build up to steady state, and it doesn't accumulate. So it gets to steady state, and it doesn't accumulate. If you forget to take this dose here, you have no protection, because there's no drug. It's all gone. If you forget to take this drug here, it doesn't matter. You've got enough amlodipine in the bloodstream to be effective. If you read the insert in the package and it says, what should I do if I forget to take a dose? It says, don't worry, take the dose the next day. So don't rush and take an additional dose. Just leave it and take the dose the next day. Now, again, this is short duration, long duration. A lot of cardiac events occur early in the morning, 8 o'clock, 9 o'clock, etc., when our blood pressure starts to rise. If you take a short-acting calcium antagonist the night before, you've got no protection in the morning. If you take amlodipine, you've got protection in the morning. So this long duration gives us compliance, gives us convenience, and gives us some cardiac protection. So it's very good for the patients. People say, should I make compounds which are close, similar to each other, or whether I should make compounds which are different? And here we have three compounds. And the only difference is the X group
which is oxygen, sulfur, or carbon. This molecule became the fourth best-selling drug in the world. These two compounds appeared in publication. So one molecular change can make a profound difference. The pharmacology is different to some extent, but also look at the half-lives. These are respectable, but they're nowhere near as good as the half-life of amlodipine. So a single molecular change has changed the pharmacology, which I haven't gone into, has also changed the half-life. I won't go into it, but when X is oxygen, we think there's an attraction, a hydrogen bond here, and when X is carbon or sulfur, there's a repulsion, and the chain drops away and can't make that ionic contraction in the membrane. So that's our theory. So this is my final slide on amlodipine. What have we done? Well, we've replaced the nitro group by chlorine, so this is now stable in white. This is an asymmetric center, but amlodipine is a racemate. If we modify the ester groups, we tune the potency to some extent. We have a hydrogen bond here, just about, and we have the basic center here, which is giving us the ionization and solubility. So we've solved the metabolism problem, we've solved the solubility problem, and we've solved the stability problem. And it's my theory that this piece of the molecule here is the bit that interacts with the calcium channel, and it sticks on the end of the calcium channel. And there was a paper in Nature last week which actually showed that amlodipine does bind to the exterior of the channel, and it binds in the way we speculated years ago. So that's part of the art and part of the innovation. Have a theory and push yourself to develop that theory. As I said before, this became the fourth best-selling drug in the world, and it's marketed as Biscin in the UK and as Norvas in the rest of the world. Okay, fine. Let me go on now to Viagra, tell you the true story, and you're going to say, oh, it was a cardiovascular drug, wasn't it? Well, the answer is yes, it was. So let me tell you how we got here. So when you take a drug to the clinic, you don't get 100% response. You might get 40, 50, whatever, but you never get 100% response. We knew that there'd be patients who didn't respond to amlodipine. So we said, what other way can we treat these patients with angina and hypertension? Now, as I said to you, amlodipine relaxes smooth muscle. That's what it does, and that's why it lowers blood pressure and why it treats angina. So we looked in the literature, and we found a molecule called cyclobalansine monophosphate, which did relax smooth muscle and did increase blood flow. So we thought, if we could increase tissue levels of that molecule, we will have an alternative approach to angina and hypertension. Now the molecule, this is made by stimulation of an enzyme called guanylate cyclase. We thought peptides were involved here, and peptides don't make very good drugs, so we didn't think we were going to go down that route. But we also knew this is broken down by an enzyme, and the enzyme is called phosphodiesterase 5. We felt if we could inhibit phosphodiesterase 5, we would increase levels of cyclic GMP in tissue, we would relax smooth muscle, and we would increase blood flow, and we would treat hypertension and angina. So that was the rationale. Nobody else had worked in this area, totally novel. The nephedipine area, as I said, other people have worked there. We were the pioneers here. Nobody had been in this area. We had nothing really to draw on. Thank you. We looked around and we found one compound called Zatinast. It did hit PDE5, but it was weak, and there were other members of the family, and it was non-selective. It was developed as an anti-allergy compound, which probably said it had very dirty pharmacology, but it did relax smooth muscle, and it did lower blood pressure. So there was a cardiovascular activity there. So this is the only lead we had, the only compound we could find that inhibited this enzyme. So we've got to transform this from a dirty compound into a drug. I won't go into this in any detail, but what we do is we looked at the electron distribution in Zatinast. We looked at the electron distribution in cyclobalansine monophosphate, and we thought that this ring and this ring would occupy the same site on the enzyme. So that was our theory. So the first thing to do was make this ring a better mimic of this. Once we've done that, if you notice here, we have the cyclic phosphate.
we've got nothing on this molecule that might occupy that position on the enzyme. So when we've optimized the heterocycle, we're going to extend from here, and we're going to extend from here. So that is our rationale. In 1985, David Robertson and I wrote a research proposal saying, let's seek phosphodiesterase-5 inhibitors for the treatment of enzyme hypertension. And this was our rationale. The chemistry was picked up by Dave Brown, Nick Terrett, and Andy Bell, and I won't go through it, but here they took the zapodafferin system, modified it to 6,5 and 6,6, and then on the next slide, I'll show you we took zapodafferin, we took one of the nitrogens out, we put a couple of methyl groups in, and you can see that we've gone from 2 micromolar to 0.3. So we've improved potency by tenfold, by rational design, not just making compounds. And we get less activity on the other members of the series, such as PD3. Now, let me just repeat, this is the molecule I've just shown you. And if this is cyclic guanosine monophosphate, here we've got the cyclic phosphate, and this has to bind to the enzyme and be hydrolyzed. So clearly the enzyme, when it looks at this molecule, says, well, there's nothing that resembles the cyclic phosphate, so clearly we can elaborate here, and we can elaborate here to increase potency. Again, we didn't have the X-ray, all of this is art and imagination, but we had a rational design. So here, we extended the methyl group to propyl, another tenfold increase in potency. And then we introduced the sulfonamide, and the cyclic phosphate is tetrahedral, the sulfonamide is tetrahedral, so we think they can occupy the same site. We put in a basic center, this is UK9248, the Viagra. And you can see here, we've got a potency of 3 nanomolar. So we've gone from micro to nano. Well, we increase potency 1,000-fold by Russian chemistry. I won't go through this. This is showing selectivity. This is 5 that we want to inhibit. 10-fold ratio over 6. Good ratio over 1. And PD3 is in the heart. And if you inhibit PD3 in the heart, you'll get arrhythmia, so we don't want that. So we've got a compound which has good selectivity for PD5. I should say phosphodiesterase is a multi-member family. I think they're up to 12 members these days. This is some pharmacology, which I won't go through, but this is the pharmacology we carried out, which encouraged us that we had a compound suitable for cardiovascular application. It did relax smooth muscle, it did elevate cyclic nitrogen monophosphate, it did work in a so-called antithrombotic model. It had a reasonable half-life, but this is a novel mechanism of action, so we're not trying to get one today yet. We're just trying to find out does the compound work in the field. So we went, remember 1985 to the proposal, we went to the clinic in 1991 and we didn't find any cardiovascular activity with the compound. So we were very disappointed. And there was pressure saying, well, why don't we ditch it? It's a novel mechanism of action. We've given it a good shot. Why don't we move on? And we said no. We will take the compound into the clinic again at the maximum tolerated dose for 10 days and we will see what we see. And if we don't see anything, we're out. And so we did that in 1992. We did a study in students in the University of Cardiff in Wales. And when our physician phoned up, Mike Allen was the physician, phoned up and said, what have you seen in this study? And the answer came back, nothing much. We've seen headache, we've seen muscle weakness, we've seen gastrointestinal disturbance. Oh, and by the way, one of the young nurses has noticed eruptions. So you have to understand what happens in a clinical trial. You get these healthy students in, right? They put them in the ward, they eat what we tell them, they drink what we tell them, they don't go out at night, but who knows what they get up to. Anyway, so that was serendipity, but it wasn't as if all of the patients showed erections, it was just one nurse anyway. So we said, well, what are we going to do with this? We didn't have grey hair in those days, so we said, well, is impotence a problem? You know, what's going on? And the answer came back from MRP people, yes, this is a erectile dysfunction, which is a significant cause of the breakup of marriage and of relationships, and yes, there is a medical need. then we said to our clinicians, well, if we do a clinical trial, how are we going to evaluate the compound? You know, you can't go around with a ruler. So they were very clever. They designed a questionnaire for the patient. And the patient with erectile dysfunction always lies. And they designed a questionnaire for the partner. And the partner who knows about erectile dysfunction never lies. So we had those two components. So we've then got, there is a medical need. We know how to evaluate it. And then the question said to us, Discovery, how is it working? We don't want a compound with no mechanism because we don't know what we're going to run into. We don't want an aphrodisiac. We want to understand exactly how this compound works. So that was the challenge for us in Discovery. Well, we knew it inhibited phosphodiesterase 5, and we knew it raised cyclic GMP. And just remember, we're in the clinic in 1991, and it was shown that the smooth muscle in the penis from impotent men has compromised relaxation. So there's a link coming up now. You know, we relax smooth muscle, it's compromising impotent men. And nitric oxide, which is something you have heard about, if we inhibit the formation of nitric oxide, then we inhibit erections. So again, there's another thing there. And if you do inject physoglanosine monophosphate into the corpus carbonatum, it does cause erections. So things are starting to come together. And in 1992, nitric oxide was voted molecule of the year. 1992, we're in the clinic. Pasteur's dictum translated to prepared mind. And on the next slide, it all comes together. So on sexual stimulation, there's a local release of nitric oxide in the penis. This stimulates guanylate cyclase. We thought the stimulant was a peptide. It's not. It's nitric oxide. It stimulates guanylate cyclase. Guanylate cyclase forms cyclic dimethyl monophosphate. That relaxes the smooth muscle, inflows blood to the penis, and that's what maintains the erection. So you can immediately see that if we inhibit the enzyme here that breaks down cyclic guanylate monophosphate, if we stop that breakdown and maintain levels, we will have better smooth muscle relaxation, better inflow, and we've got a rational approach now to treating impotence. So it all comes together. This is some biochemistry, but it just shows that we've got regular inhibition and we've got a 1,000-fold increase in potency. Now, for this program, we were using the phosphoesterase 5 from rabbit platelet because that was a convenient source. We had to get some from the human corpus cavernosum, the penis, and in fact, we can see that the potency of the compound on the rabbit and on the human enzyme is the same. So that's good. Could be lucky, but that's good. And also, we showed that this enzyme did degrade cyclic guanosine monophosphate in the corpus cavernosum. So that was good. Here, again, what we want to do is we want to raise levels of cyclic guanosine monophosphate. And here in the rabbit corpus cavernosum, we have a dose-related increase in cyclic guanosine monophosphate, and this is exactly what we want to do. And if you don't get a dose response, then there's something fishy with the compound. We want a nice dose response, and we've got one now. So we put all this pharmacology together, we now know how it works, and we can go into the clinic. So here, and this is patients reporting improved erections. You see we've got a nice dose response, 10, 25, and 50 mg, and we get up to an 88% response rate. Now, where you should be looking is at placebo, because these guys don't receive anything in the tablet, and 40% of them telling us they're getting improved erections. So, you know, but there is a serious side here. Often drugs fail because the placebo response improves. So if you take a new antidepressant to the clinic, and you have a treated group and a placebo group, the placebo group will improve because you're paying them attention. Somebody is coming into the doctor's paying them attention, they're feeling better, they get better. And that placebo response then makes the drug response look smaller. Placebo response doesn't last for long. And it's very difficult sometimes with antidepressants and others to actually get them to cool. So this is a killer if you can't control it. But it's also amusing. Okay, if we now go to erectile dysfunction, it can be organic or atherosclerosis, it can be psychogenic, or it can be mixed. And you can see here the responses are pretty good, whatever the cause, and the placebo responses are coming down. Erectile dysfunction, co-existent diabetes,
pretty good response. Hypertension, okay. Now, radical prostatectomy, you'd say, what's going on? That's a very poor response. When the surgeon goes in to take out your prostate, he or she often takes out the nerves around the penis. And so there is less nitric oxide being released, there is less for the drug to work on, and that's why we get that other response. These are the guys who've played rugby and, you know, have got broken their back, had a riding accident or whatever. We get any number of letters from them saying, Viagra's changed my life, I'm getting married, I'm going to have kids. This, we believe this is a serious drug, this is not a recreational drug. So that's very important. Now, I'm not going to go through these in detail, but this is the patients at baseline. You can look at any parameter you want. This is the effect of Viagra, and this is the age match controls. And what we're doing with Viagra, we're bringing Viagra-treated patients are the same as age match controls. So we're bringing a subnormal function up to normal. We're not taking a normal function and making it supernormal. And I think that's nicely expressed there. Some side effects. There were reports of cardiovascular effects, and if you remember reading in the Sun a few years ago, but there aren't any serious cardiovascular side effects. We have to report all the side effects, whether they're serious or not, and you could say, gosh, 16% headaches, flushing, indigestion, nasal congestion. That, you know, doesn't look very nice. But look at the discontinuation rate, 2.5% versus 2.3%. When you do a clinical trial, you give the patient the tablets, and when you come to the end, you ask for the tablets back. These guys wouldn't give us the tablets back. So, and there have been people on this since it was launched in 1998, and it is a perfectly safe drug. There is an incidence of altered vision, and I don't know if you remember, I showed you there was a tenfold ratio between PDE5 and PDE6. There was a PDE6 in the eye, and we're probably inhibiting that, and some people have an inability to distinguish red from green. And the Federal Aviation Agency in America tells pilots not to take Viagra 3 hours before they take off, because they get to the end of the runway and they can't tell red from green. Why they want to take it 3 hours before takeoff, I don't know. So this is the team. Nick Terrett should be here, but you can see chemistry, biology, clinical. So drug discovery is really multidisciplinary. And to get this drug to the market, we probably involved over 1,000 people at Pfizer. We wrote the research proposal in 1985, and I was in New York for the launch of the drug on my birthday, March 27th, 1998. So 1985 to 1999, it took 13 years, and that's not slow by any means. But it was good to be involved from day one writing the research proposal and actually to be in America when it was launched. I just got some final slides to finish up on. People say, you know, what's the future of the pharmaceutical industry? Well, I think there's still tremendous challenges out there. This came when I made this slide some time ago, 1992. 2020 sounded a long way off, and I didn't have anything to worry about, but it's just around the corner. But ischemic heart disease is still the number one killer. This is the developing and the developed world. As the developing world pick up our dietary habits, they are prone to cardiovascular disease just as much as we were. So ischemic heart disease coming down in the West, but going up in the developing countries. There are over 100 million Chinese with diabetes, and obesity is an endemic in India. So, cerebrovascular disease or stroke, this is terribly debilitating for the patient, the healthcare system, and the family. We have taken over 100 drugs to the clinic for stroke, and not one has worked, apart from the clotbusters. I'm not going to take the clotbuster, they work okay. But we've taken 100 drugs and they don't work because the animal model we use, we do an acute occlusion of an artery in the brain and we then see what the drug does on damage. That's nothing like a stroke in humans. The animal models don't work, but this is their work. Chronic obstructive pulmonary disease is 6, it's now number 3, and this is being driven by the millions of smoking deaths in China. And it's going to increase until China gets smoking under control. So there's still some major challenges for us. What do I think the therapies will be? Well, amlodipine and Viagra are small molecules, so I think there's still going to be a future for small molecules. Antibodies are very popular, they're very expensive, but I think we're still going to see antibodies. And I think there's a role for vaccines.
gene therapy for very special applications. There are some ocular applications. Ribozymes, very difficult to deliver antisense and RNA antigens and antisense. So I'd like to see these come forward out of the world. So I think there's a great future for chemists. If you want a molecule taken by mouth with reasonable, at a reasonable cost, then it's a small molecule. Amlodipine costs $500 a year. Some of the anti-cancer Humira, the best-selling drug at the moment, is about $100,000 a year. So if you want the amlodipine type cost-effective therapies, $500, it's got to be a small molecule. If you'd had an antibody for cholesterol, people would probably not have gone to their doctors every week or every month for an injection because they haven't got any symptoms, but they're quite happy to take a statin. So I guess, so I go small molecules, antibodies, and some vaccines. And where did pharma go wrong? I think pharma went wrong on thinking we could solve all the problems by numbers. So we take 10 compounds to the clinic and we get one drug. So let's take 100 compounds to the clinic and we get 10 drugs. So the whole process was industrialized. There was numbers, 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 automation, 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 high throughput everything, and I think ability to think went out of the window. People just were mesmerized by numbers. This is my model. Give me the best technology. I'm not going to win Formula One and Ford Focus, Ford Escort. So give me the best technology. The leader here has got to be courageous, got to have vision, got to know what he or she is doing, able to lead the team. But races are won or lost in the pits. So it's the guys in the pits, it's the team that really makes it. So you need the best technology base, strong leadership, but also really good teamwork. And drug discovery, to me, is a shared experience, not a mechanical event. Here's a mechanical event, and here's a shared experience. So I think this is my last slide. So what have I found with respect to success? And I'm talking about drug discovery, which probably is relevant. In drug discovery, teamwork is very essential. I'm very keen to quality control. So I want the best chemist, I want the best biologist, I want the best drug metabolism. And I want to blend them in a team where they understand what each other's doing, but I don't want the chemist to become an amateur biologist and try and be better than the biologist. I want the best, the quality control, but to blend them in a team. Teams sometimes become too big. I remember walking down the corridor at Pfizer once, and there's a stream of people coming back past me, and I said, "Where's the fire?" And they said, "Oh no, it's a team meeting." So they can get too big. So you then have everybody wants to throw their competitors. So you need a partnership. You need the leading chemist, the leading biologist, the leading chemist, get together, make the decisions, but then communicate with the team. So I'm happy to have team meetings and people. Teaching, people say don't do this, don't do that. It's don't do this because. And I think we've all got experience. Don't make nitro compounds because we've seen this and that and they're toxic. So I think the great responsibility you have to take informality, it's got a lot better since I entered industry, it's all suits and ties and knock on the door. Idea sharing. I go to places where people say, "I've got a folder full of ideas," but they're not going to tell anyone because they'll all be pinched. And if you've got that time, I think you'd do it. So if you've got an idea, as I showed you down there, share it. Talk to your colleagues. Get them to help with you develop it. Information bites. I think people have gone mad collecting information. I think from older people, we've had a very simple sequence. We collected information, we interpreted it, and moved on. Now people want every compound in every test system. And I just feel, you've got to give me information bites that I can digest. And I'm probably going to offend people in the room, but these idiots walking down the street constantly on their iPhones, what are they looking at? What are they doing? It's a great way to pass the day and come in and do 200 emails, and that's your morning gone. But you're not going to discover any drugs that way. You have to create time to look out of the window and think. It's very easy to be busy on your internet, on your mobile phone, along transatlantic travel. Create time to think. We don't have much choice. Other people are out there, and they're being competitive. You've got to move fast. And then size. When I was head of research at Pfizer, we had 2,000 people, which was big. When Pfizer merged with Wyeth, they had 10,000 people, which is impossible. Now, you can't manage innovation, in my view, on a 10,000-person scale. You've got to break it down into manageable bites. I'm a great fan of the Roman Centurion. I like 100 people. When I had 100 chemists, I knew everything they did. I knew what they were working on. When I had 200 chemists, it started to go a little bit flaky. So I like the Roman Centurion. There's a number called Dunbar's number. Dunbar's number is 150, and that's the number of contacts we can make, massive more or less, as humans, some strong, some weak. And in the Doomsday Book, once the village became over 150, they broke up and founded a new one. So these numbers, if somebody tells me I've got 2,000 people reported to me, I say that's a structure that doesn't work. So I like to break it down. Okay, I think we'll finish there. And all of this takes place in Sandwich, in Kent. Sandwich in the 1600s was the second biggest port in the UK, but the river silted up, so the sea is about 3 miles out here. Julius Caesar's first fort was on the sea, and it's over there, but it's inland. And because of that, the town was left exactly as it is. Was so if you want the best row of Elizabethan timber buildings in the UK, go to Sandwich. And when I first came, I drove around the corner and there was a toll keeper here and he charged you sixpence to cross the bridge. I'm happy to say we now have because of the open golf championship, we now have a bypass. But I'm going to finish there and just say I can't imagine a more exciting and rewarding career than to have been a Pfizer, also being a minister chemist, and I'd really like to thank all of my colleagues and collaborators for, over the years, it's been tremendous, and also like to thank you for your attention. Thank you.
Thank you, Sir Simon, for that wonderful tour de force of that excellent discovery stories. Can I take some questions?
Yes.
I wonder if you'd just like to wait while our microphone holders to magicians and you can put your hand up with my phone.
Hello, I'm Arvind Jadhav. There are two other more molecules like Viagra, acetaminophen, like urimbine and prostaglandin E1. And they were trying to, what you could inject in the paranasal. And they were also quite effective. And I'm just wondering whether you tried to use them.
They inhibited PDE1?
PDE1.5.
PD5. Are you talking about the competitive compounds, the one from Bayer?
I don't know which company.
Urimbine
actually is a very common plant.
Urimbine.
And the prostaglandin E1 is?
Urimbine, I don't think does very much, no. What I should have said was that Viagra, of course, was the leading drug for erectile dysfunction and sold over $2 billion in industry. There was a compound from Bayer, which was a similar structure, and there was also another compound, a quite different structure, that were launched 4 years afterwards. These work, but they never, Viagra, just that name captured anyone, and they were just never able to catch up. But there certainly are two competitive drugs out there that work. But Urimbine used to be used as antihypertensive agents, and there might have been a side effect of erectile dysfunction, but it's not safe enough to use anything.
Do you think Viagra can be what you call used in the patch?
Pardon?
Can it be used in the skin patch?
Viagra?
Yeah.
Well, I'm sure it can, but why would you want to do it? Well, when you take Viagra, you have a thought in mind, so, you know. and patches, you know, the patches can be pretty nasty things. You can get quite nasty bruises from them. They're not the thing people think are, you know, the bee's knees. So I think people, no, it's not like hypertension where you have no symptoms, very symptomatic, and you think, why am I taking this stuff twice a day? With Viagra, you have an intention, and I think taking it all is popular. But no doubt it could be given to you by a patch, but we never do.
Thank you.
use the expression rational design a few times during your lecture. Why, in your opinion, has the use of molecular modelling been so relatively unsuccessful in drug design, given the ever-increasing power of computers and maybe speed? I'm thinking of things like the Oxford Cancer Project a few years ago, Screensaver.
Yeah. So. We didn't have any crystal structures here, but if we had crystal structures, I would have done structure-based drug design. All of the stuff you saw about the electron distribution confirmation, we did with computers. So I would use any discipline to discover a drug. I just think there's a human element at the end of the day, and people expect the computer to have the whole answer. You have to interpret what the computer's telling you. But I think if you've got intuition, green fingers, plus the best technology, that is the way to go. So personally, I don't eliminate any technology for discovering drugs.
Just to come back on it. Sorry, what I had in mind was more screening for potential molecules,
yeah,
based on shape and structure.
Well, you can do virtual screening, and people say it's not been selected. There's a paper, not being successful. There was a very nice paper from an artist in Nature 2 weeks ago in which they discovered a new antimalarial. They did virtual screens, they got hits, they elaborated the hits, and they got a drug. Now, if you consider your protein as a fixed entity, the virtual screening probably won't work very well because it's flexing all the time. So if you can back that screening with molecular dynamics, you will increase your chance of success very well. If you think the protein is just like a piece of chewing gum, then you're probably not going to be very successful. These things are flexing and moving, and you've got to take that into account.
Thank you, Simon, for a splendid talk, I must say. It's most impressive. To follow the rational design question, you know, the definition of rational design is not a very, very close one. And it did seem to me that in the first part of your talk, taking nifedipine to amlodipine in a four-pronged attack, mm-hmm, in which you knew exactly what you're trying to do, and every step followed the one before, and the result of that.
Mm-hmm.
And that, to my mind, is the best definition I've ever heard, mm-hmm, of practical rational design.
Mm-hmm.
So I congratulate you.
Okay.
I don't have a question, I have a request. Can you not write this up in a way which would appeal to sixth formers? Because I believe it is the way forward. You showed it rationally,
mm-hmm,
absolutely perfectly in your talk.
I did write it up some time ago, but that was in a clinical journal. I can think about it, yes. I'm happy for anybody to use the slides.
And chemistry and industry, of course, is a good organ for this sort of work.
Okay, thank you.
On a lighter note, how did the name Viagra arise?
That's a Viagra joke, how did it arise, but anyway. And as the Queen said when she touched me on the shoulder with the sword, arise to sign. Anyway. When we name drugs, we usually like to give sort of an impression of what they do. So doxazosine is a once-daily antihypertensive. So car-dura, cardiac dura duration. So give you an idea. Amlodipine is for hypertension and angina. So the Norvasc, normalize the vascular flow. Okay, that to give you some idea. We did not want to name that gave any hint of what Viagra did because we could see the jokes. So we went and looked at the trademarks we had on file, and we picked the one that had no connotations, nothing at all, and that's where Viagra came from. Otherwise, we would have picked a name which suggested what it did, and it would just have been a laughing stock. So we just, off the shelf, one we had. People are trying to say, do you mean Niagara? Do you mean this? No, it's got no connotations.
About the 13 years it took from your first research proposal to get into the market. What were your biggest frustrations in those 13 years, and how how did you overcome them?
I think Viagra is a little bit unusual in that you took it for cardiovascular, didn't work, and we probably lost 2 or 3 years there. We didn't really know whether we wanted to do erectile dysfunction, so we probably lost some time ago. I would have thought we could shave it down to 10 years if we hadn't had that. If we'd been going for erectile dysfunction from day one, we could have gone for 10 years or even less. We only did 5,000 patients for registration. If you've got a cardiovascular drug, some of the trials are 20,000, 30,000. We only did 5,000 patients. So I think we could have got it. I think if it had been erectile dysfunction from day one, we'd have got there in 10 years or less. And often the time scales get elongated because you can always go faster if you want to put more money in. So, you know, if you've got a phase one trial, you could be gearing up for phase two and spending millions, not knowing the results of the phase one. So people tend to be a bit conservative. They wait until they get a result and then they make the big investment. If people want to invest up front, I think they can go faster there. I think the regulatory authorities have been very helpful. Although, you know, if you want a new drug in diabetes, you've got to do a 3-year trial to show it has no cardiovascular liability. You know, some of the demands are getting very, very heavy. Some of the demands are getting very heavy. But I think we could have done 10 years or less for Viagra. With amlodipine, the development path was absolutely marked out because the therapy had been there. We knew what we had to do. Again, we didn't have a great number of patients. I think we'd have done it in about 10 years.
One last question.
Alan Heaton, a more general point now. The general public, of course, reads about the vast amount of money that drug firms rake in from selling these blockbuster drugs. Hundreds of millions or even billions, as you've said, per year. But of course, what they don't appreciate is how much it's cost to develop them. Mm-hmm. Now, you said it took 13 years. Could you give us some idea of the total cost of it?
Well, people say that it takes $1 billion. I can't tell you, I don't know. At least 500 million, at least half a billion would be my guess. I don't know. But we only had 5,000 patients, so that was relatively short. I think we've gone from a situation where people argued the cost on the cost of R&D. You know, so we charge because we have to recuperate. Now we're seeing anti-cancers at $100,000 a year. We're seeing rare disease drugs at $300,000 a year. We're seeing dimethylfumarate for multiple sclerosis at $57,000 a year. You know, it's a penny a ton. So I think pharma is charging what the market will bear now. And I'm not sure that the prices do relate to the cost of R&D. They're now saying in cancer we can charge $100,000, we charge $100,000. And so I think pricing is going in a direction that I don't really support. Now, you might say, well, that's the way you price the Volkswagen Polo. This is what the market will bear. And I think the drug companies have gone down that route, and I think they've become greedy. You see the pushback from NICE. And if you want to see the pharmaceutical industry collapse, vote for Hillary Clinton. Because she tried it in 1990, and she'll come again. And once American prices go down, it's 2 to 3 times the rest of the world. The pharma industry will really suffer. Now, I think we need to get our act together before that. But I think pricing could be the single biggest difficulty facing the pharmaceutical industry.
Is that why the pharmaceutical companies are perceived as having little interest in antibiotics?
Well, yes and no. So, you know, we put a lot of work in, and we need new antibiotics for us to make a lot of it. So, we put a lot of work into a broad, we want a compound that will work against resistant strains. Okay? So, we're getting resistance in the hospital. We want a compound that will work against resistant strains. So, we develop one. And we take it to the doctor, and the doctor puts it on the shelf and says, I'm only going to use that in an emergency. So by definition, there is no market. There's just no market. Now, and so pharmaceuticals do need to healthcare, but we are commercial. And therefore, to invest in drugs with no market will not make sense. But now there are consortia of pharmaceutical companies getting together, governments are getting together, we've had the report from law, whatever it was, we've just resigned. So I think there will be some movement. But the question is, where's the new chemistry matter going to come from? We've screened all our files, we've screened our natural products, you know, where's the new chemistry matter going to come from? I don't think, to me, the challenge is getting the compound into the blood. And I don't think we know enough about how to get into gram positive, and even less about how to get into gram negative. And I would invest fundamentally in understanding how to get into those drugs, what are the transporters, what's from the compound down. That's where I would put my money, and then I'd come forward and do chemical matter. So I don't think we've got our strategy right.
I appreciate that there are lots more questions. There will be an opportunity to change it through to Simon after the event. It's my pleasure to be able to present to someone with a certificate.
For the talk today.
Thank you very much. Before we go and enjoy the refreshments, I just remind you that there is another lecture coming up on the Tuesday, the 25th of October. We have Sir Colin Berry, What Have They Put in My Food and Should I Worry? It will be interesting. But please join us for canapes and wine in the garden room, and please can you just thank Sir Samuel for the next